ask you to remain standing for just a moment. Several of our children were at the elementary camp this week, and it was called Whose We Are. I had the privilege of teaching in air conditioning, and I led the Bible games. So one of the things the kids learned this week was that you have the major prophets of the Old Testament, and they talk a lot. That's why they're called major, and there's lots of chapters to them. And then you have the minor prophets. They're not very long. They're shorter books. They don't talk as much. So one of the shorter books we looked at was actually a one-chapter book of the minor prophet Obadiah. Very short. And then there was Isaiah, 66 chapters long. In a very sacred moment, looking at the whole group, I was asking the group, what kind of sermons does your pastor preach? Obadiah sermons or Isaiah sermons? And I looked over at the saintly little angels from Polk Street, one of whom stands before you now. And they all blurted, as you might imagine with the giggly little grin right now, when I said, does your pastor preach short little Obadiah sermons or long Isaiah sermons? They all together said what, Katie?
Isaiah.
But we learned how to use the Bible this week in a better way. And so here's the theme of the week that we're going to get into reading the scripture. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Because that's who God is.
And that's whose we are.
And that's where the camp came from. So the camp name came from. So I also want to give a shout out to Ken Knight, who spent all week putting things together. A lot of the folks from Lake Ridge United Methodist in Lubbock who provided leadership and volunteers of our church who went down. So listen now to the words of the scripture from John chapter 15, verses 5 through 17, as Katie reads them for us.
I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, and you bear much fruit and become my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another and as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed to you to go and bear fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commandments so that you may love one another. This is
the word of God for the people of God.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Katie. You may be seated. And as you are, let us bow together for prayer. I love the way, before you pray, don't you just love the spirit of that? Great job, Katie. Let's bow together for prayer. Awaken our hearts now, O God, to the presence of your spirit. And may your spirit stand between those of us who speak this morning and your people, so that all that we say will be transformed and clearly communicated in ways that help move our hearts to be faithful disciples and followers of Christ. In whose name we gather, in whose name we pray, and in whose name we will depart to serve. And all of God's people did say, Amen. Last year, I guess it was maybe October, our church council got together, and the Northwest Texas Annual Conference that we're a part of had mentioned to us the opportunity and possibility that a pastor would be coming from another country and to start a new ministry initiative reaching the Spanish-speaking culture. So our church council last year said we would be open to the idea of providing office space for that and to be as supportive as we can. Now, usually the visa process for a work visa on the United States side moves a bit quicker than in other cultures. And a pastor was identified in Cuba, Reverend Emerson Cruz Pena, and the paperwork was put in for the work visa, etc., and it was sent to Havana, Cuba. And we thought that that would take at least a year, probably more. And it happened a bit quicker than we thought. So in July, Pastor Cruz and his wife Maida arrived in Lubbock, and 3 days later, they were here in Amarillo. The basic way to understand this is that Pastor Emelson is a missionary that our conference has identified and brought to Amarillo. And for the next 2 years, the Hispanic ministries of our conference is funding his entire work. And the only thing they're asking for us at this point is to provide office space and support. Some of you have provided phenomenal support in providing the items over the past couple weeks. I want to say thank you. We greatly, greatly appreciate that. So hopefully you understand. He'll office here. You'll see him here. And in these next 2 years, it's a very simple concept. Polk Street United Methodist Church will be given the opportunity to think about what do we want to do to be a partner in this ministry from the year, third year, fourth year, and beyond. I've had a chance to spend quite a bit of time with Emelson and his wife, Maida. I live between being humbled and inspired just at their spirit and their willingness. Having left Cuba with two suitcases and trusting God. Their passports and the American work visa. He now has a Social Security card. We're waiting on the driver's license, and things are progressing. I want to first introduce to you Pastor Reverend Emelson Cruz Pena and his wife Maida, if you will stand both now. And welcome to Amarillo. And because my Spanish is not so great, or I should say, mi amigo de Cristo Emelson, ¿cómo es mi español? ¿Así, así?
It's perfect.
It's perfect.
No.
Yeah. Okay. You need to know that they basically, Maida and Emelson, please be seated. We could not do what we've done as a church in the past 3 weeks without Pauline Zukowski. Now, you need to know that when Jimmy Nunn, the director of our conference ministries, and Jorge Ochoa, the director of Hispanic ministry, said, do you have anyone who can translate? I said, yeah, I've got Pauline Zukowski. And Jorge, who's from Peru, said, I think you have the wrong country, Pastor Brent. I said, no, you don't understand. That's her married name. Honestly, we couldn't do what we've done. Pauline has provided transportation and, more importantly, correct translation for us, which has been indispensable in the past 4 weeks. So I want to thank you publicly.
I've enjoyed it. They're a blessing to me.
Well, it's you've been a blessing. So, Pastor Cruz, Pastor Emelson is with us. What I wanted to do is give you a chance to get sort of a snapshot of his journey, his life, and who he is. I always like to know about people, how did they come to the church? How did they come to the Christian faith? So that's where we're going to start this morning's conversation. And I want you to know that David Letterman and that new guy on the Tonight Show got nothing to worry about, okay? So how did he come to faith in Christ?
¿Cómo fue que entró a Cristo usted?
Bueno, mi generación, la generación en la que viví, nací, crecí hasta el momento, fue una generación que se desarrolló en un país con una ideología marxista.
Okay. In his religion, in his country, he works. He was there developed in the situation of the culture is more of a machista, very strong dominance men.
Era una ideología centralizada en el hombre, muy materialista y mucho ateísmo.
It was mainly centered against the man, being a machista, very materialistic, and very atheist.
Aunque uno pueda desarrollarse en una sociedad así,
even though you can develop and grow in a community of that sort,
siempre en el corazón del hombre hay una necesidad, un vacío que necesita ser llenado por Dios.
He always had an emptiness in his heart that he felt needed to be filled by God.
En mi país, mencionar el nombre de Dios,
in his country, to mention the name of God,
podía costarle a uno la universidad, la escuela.
It can cost you going to college or having an education.
Se sancionaba a aquella persona que dijera solamente Dios.
They would sanction the person just even mentioning the name of God.
Pues tratamos de llenar el vacío de nuestro corazón.
They attempted to fill the emptiness of his heart.
A través de una vida llena de placeres y vicios.
Filled with a life of pleasures and bad things.
Y por supuesto, ese estilo de vida no trae felicidad.
And of course, that style of life does not bring any happiness.
Estaba casado con una buena mujer.
He is married with a beautiful and wonderful wife.
Pero no había felicidad porque no hay familia que pueda prosperar sin Dios.
Because there was not much happiness in the marriage because there was not a God-centered family.
Cuando me casé con mi esposa,
when he married his wife,
mi plan era tener una familia feliz.
His plan was to have a happy and fruitful family.
Pero descubrí que lo que teníamos era un infierno.
What he recognized is that their marriage is more like a fiery, very turmoil.
Mis hijas crecieron en un ambiente traumático.
His children grew up in a very traumatic ambiance.
Pero un día, cuando ya mi vida estaba llegando al límite,
one day when his life was getting to the limit,
estaba totalmente desesperado.
He was very desperate.
Pasó una jovencita por frente a mi casa, una vecina nuestra, una adolescente.
There was a little neighbor, 11-year-old girl, that walked in front of him.
Y ella llevaba un gran libro en su mano.
And she had a large book.
Y a mí me gustó siempre leer desde muy joven.
He always has enjoyed readings as a child.
Le pregunté a esta jovencita que qué libro era ese.
He asked the young girl, what is that book that you're carrying?
Y ella me dijo, una Biblia.
A Bible.
Y me llamó la atención porque en mi país no abundaban las Biblias.
It draw his attention because in his country you don't have a lot of Bibles.
Nuestros abuelos nos decían que el que leía la Biblia terminaba loco.
His grandparents used to tell him, for the people who read the Bible will sure enough go crazy.
Those son los baptistas.
Los baptistas.
Baptista, Presbyterian.
Y para el sistema, la Biblia era como veneno. Estaba prohibido acercarse a una Biblia.
So in his system, the Bible was prohibited. They were not allowed to read the scriptures or even obtain a Bible.
Pues yo le pedí que me prestara la Biblia.
He asked the young lady if he can borrow the Bible.
No por ninguna motivación espiritual.
Not for a spiritual motivation, but just for the curiosity.
El sector más profesional de la sociedad donde yo vivía decía que para tener una cultura completa, era necesario leer la Biblia.
The culture people in the society of Cuba, some of them did believe that you got to have some culture, and in order to obtain that culture, you needed to read the Bible.
Pero no sabía que Dios me estaba tendiendo una trampa de amor.
But he didn't realize that God had planted a seed in his heart.
Comencé a leer mi Biblia desde los libros de Moisés.
He started reading the Bible beginning with Moses.
Sabemos que los que no tienen una cultura cristiana de fe, le es difícil entender eso.
He says it was very hard to understand because he did not have the faith foundation in the beginning.
Vi tantos sacrificios, ríos de sangre y no entendía nada.
He read so many sacrifices and so much bloodshed.
Pero me propuse leer mi Biblia.
But he was determined to read the Bible.
Cuando llegué al Nuevo Testamento y leí el primer capítulo de Mateo,
when he got to the First Testament and read Matthew,
ahí ese primer capítulo está la genealogía hasta Jesús.
In that first chapter is the genealogy of Jesus.
Y me parecía que estaba leyendo una guía telefónica.
He felt like he was reading a line, a telephone line that has different connections.
Y dije, yo creo que esta es la parte donde los abuelos dicen que uno se vuelve loco.
He said that's the part that he felt his probably grandparents were right and he was going crazy.
Pero en el capítulo 5, en el Sermón de la Montaña,
but in the chapter 5, in the Sermon on the Mountain,
descubrí que mis lágrimas comenzaron a correr por mi rostro.
He realized that he was crying.
Y comencé a sentirme culpable y que era enemigo de Dios.
At that point he realized that he was a sinner and that he had been an enemy of God.
Pero descubrí que Dios había mandado a su hijo a salvarnos.
But he realized that God has sent his son to save him.
Descubrí que había perdón aunque había ofendido a Dios durante toda mi vida.
He realized that he had forgiveness even though he had rejected Jesus all his lifetime.
Sin nunca antes haber visitado una iglesia,
without ever having to visit a church,
sin saber lo que era un pastor,
without knowing what a pastor was,
estaba yo solo aceptando a Jesús en mi casa.
He was on his own accepting Jesus Christ as his Savior.
Y el cambio fue así.
And the change was instant.
Mi esposa comenzó a dudar de si yo estaba en mis cabales.
His wife started thinking that he was crazy.
Mi esposa decía, ¿qué le pasa a este ahora?
What's going on with him? What's going on?
Ya no me maltrata.
He's no longer a bad husband. He no longer mistreats me.
No dice palabras indecentes.
He no longer speaks foul language.
Pero ella no entendía que había un cambio en mi corazón.
But she didn't realize at that time that there was a change in his heart.
Nuestra experiencia influenció a mi esposa y hoy más de 40 sirven al Señor en toda mi familia.
So that experience not only influenced his wife but also influenced his family, which 40 members of his family are now members of the church.
Y le doy gracias a Dios porque ya en mi país en este momento no es como en el pasado.
Now he gives thanks to God because now the Cuba is not like it is to be.
A través de nuestro ministerio hemos traído más de 1,500 almas a Cristo.
With his ministry alone, he has saved over 1,500 lives.
Y estamos experimentando un verdadero avivamiento en nuestra nación. Hay mucha Biblia, hay mucha predicación.
And now the church prosper in Cuba. There's a lot of preaching, there's a lot of sermons, and there's opportunity to reach God in Cuba.
Y ya no es un problema decir Dios.
And now it's not a problem to say God in Cuba.
Bueno. ¿Cuántos niños y niñas? How many boys and girls in his ministry did he reach to bring to faith in Christ?
¿Cuántos niños ha alcanzado usted de vidas salvadas en su ministerio?
Personas en total, más de 1,500 personas.
Altogether, a little bit over 1,500.
Ahora, tuvimos 3 años siendo pastores de jóvenes antes de venir a los Estados Unidos.
For the last 3 years, he had served as a youth pastor as well.
Y tuvimos ministrando entre 5,500 y 6,000 jóvenes.
With that, had an attendance of between 5,000 and 6,000 youth that he ministered to in the past 3 years.
One of the reasons that Emelson was identified by Jorge Ochoa and Jimmy Nunn is that over 5,000 youth would gather at a gathering that have been affected because of the ministry that is known as Pastor Emelson's ministry. It's very personalized in Cuba. And, you know, we think about, here I am the pastor of this church, and one of the challenges for us is that we tend to think church is the building, and we forget that really that's nowhere in the New Testament. The building is a fantastic symbol. We're very proud of the building as a symbol of hope. But I want to give you a little insight into what ministry looks like for Emelson in Cuba before coming here. Well, we have churches, and then we do ministries like mission work after we establish the church. So we got Polk Street, and then we send the men to Four Corners. We send the youth here and there. It's just the opposite in Cuba. But we'll start with how many churches? Not only a pastor, but also a district superintendent. How many churches was Emelson responsible for overseeing in the last year before he came?
Antes de venirse, ¿cuántas iglesias usted estuvo responsable que usted mantenía como distrito?
12 iglesias y 20 misiones.
He gathered 12 churches and 20 missions.
And how do they start a new church in Cuba? Do they start the church or they start the home first?
¿Cómo comienza en Cuba la iglesia? ¿Comienza la iglesia primero o la misión?
Se comienza por la misión.
The mission starts first. And then you build.
Sí, la experiencia básica de cómo se desarrolla una iglesia en Cuba es una persona tiene una experiencia.
A person has a personal experience.
Esa persona impacta a su familia.
That person impacts a family.
Esa familia impacta a sus vecinos.
That family impacts the neighbors.
Y cuando somos más de 25 ya tenemos una iglesia.
When you have more than 25, you have a church.
And on a Sunday, he had a church in his home, right? So,
El domingo tenía cuántas y cuántos servicios tenía los domingos en su casa?
En cuatro servicios en nuestra iglesia, la iglesia. Tenemos tres servicios más la escuela dominical.
He had a total of four services, three that were Cuban and one was that Dominican that were all held in his house. So a total of four church services.
Y se desarrollaban así más o menos. Lo primero que hacíamos a las 6 de la mañana, desayunábamos con los convertidos del mes.
Okay, so about 6 o'clock in the morning, they would start their day and they would have a prayer opportunity and breakfast with the people that had been saved that month.
Luego venía la escuela dominical y yo hacía más o menos lo que hace Pastor Bart. Recorríamos las aulas y...
So basically what he would do after that, he would unite with the Dominican preachers and Dominican students, and then they would walk around and kind of like what they did today, get around, meet all the Sunday school students and so forth.
Y luego yo predicaba a las 11 de la mañana, a las 4 de la tarde y a las 8 de la noche.
So he would have his sermons at 11, at 4, and at 8 o'clock at night.
How long would a service last? Ooh, listen carefully.
¿Qué tan largo duraban los servicios?
Cerca de 3 horas.
Close to 3 hours.
Con mucho ruido.
With lots of noise and very loud and very, very joyful.
Aquí me siento como en el cielo.
He says here he feels like he's in heaven because it's very calm. Very calm.
Who was a person in his life that was very important for his faith in Christ?
¿Quién fue la persona más importante para su fe en Cristo?
El pastor Moisés Isla.
A pastor by the name of Moisés Isla.
Y Dios nos dio el privilegio de que él viajara conmigo a Texas.
He had the privilege of the pastor traveling with him to Texas.
Está haciendo este mismo ministerio, pero en otra iglesia de aquí del distrito.
He's doing the same ministry, but another different district here in Texas.
Este pastor fue una inspiración para mi vida.
The pastor has been an inspiration to his life.
Él impartió un curso de homilética en la iglesia, o sea, curso de preparación para predicadores.
This pastor instituted a preaching sermon like a school for theology.
Yo llevaba una semana solamente en la iglesia.
He had only been there 1 week in the church.
Y me colé en el curso.
And they enrolled him in the course to become a preacher.
Y la esposa dice que miraba y decía, ¿qué hace él aquí?
His wife would say, What is he doing here?
Una semana ya quería ser predicador.
He said, he's only been 1 week in the service and he already wanted to be a preacher.
Pero él estuvo fe en mi pasión y comenzó a prepararme y llegué a ser el hombre que Dios.
He saw the faith and the potential in him and he prayed and he is the man he is because of the dedication and the determination of the pastor.
You know, we've had a chance to look. We have what's called a demographic map that shows where different ethnicities live in Amarillo. Some of you may not know that there are over 400 Cuban people that are in Amarillo. So one of the reasons that Jorge identified Pastor Emelson from Cuba is somewhat of that immediate connection. But when we looked at where to live, there were houses in Amarillo. The only place more difficult to rent a house than Amarillo is Odessa, or Midland area. So it didn't translate when I said it could be worse. I mean, you could be living in Odessa. So we've had to kind of look quickly. And so it's like literally we find a house, Pauline finds a house, we make a phone call, and sometimes those are very quick. And the first thing that Emelson looked at on the map is he would look around, and it may be a house, but he would say, do the people live here that I would reach? And when he looked at the map, we found a particular house that we think we've got a lead on that's in the Caprock area. And Emelson basically said, this is where I hope we can live because the people that I would reach are here. He's got such a heart for where the people are. That's where he wants to live. Now, I don't want to call you out in public, Billy, but it might need a little help for mowing the yard the first time. Might knock it down a little bit, so... won't ask you to commit all the way, but may need a knockdown. And I was just so amazed at this tenacious, humble spirit to be where the people are. So I'm going to ask him now about that house we looked at. And I'm going to ask him about how is he going to look at starting this ministry to reach people. So how would he start that ministry if we could get the house that we looked at? How would that ministry look like? What will it look like to start that ministry? Who will he reach?
Si agarramos la casa que estamos pensando ya junto a Cap Rock, esto, la casa que vimos, ¿cómo usted piensa comenzar su ministerio? ¿Cómo va a ser la primera cosa?
Bueno, yo estoy en un contexto totalmente diferente al que viví.
He's in a whole completely different environment than what he lived, used to live in.
Aquí cuando uno pasa por una ciudad no ve a nadie.
He says here when you drive through the city you don't see many people outside.
Parece que sonó la trompeta y Cristo se lo llevó a todos.
He said it sounds like God sang that blow the trumpet and everybody disappeared.
Estoy acostumbrado a una ciudad muy caribeña.
There's a he's used to an environment where there was lots of people.
Y puedo hablar constantemente a las personas.
And he can just freely be able to speak to people, multiple people, as he as his walk through the day.
A veces aquí miro alrededor y me da deseo de salir corriendo.
He looks around sometimes and he wants to run.
Porque no sé cómo empezar.
Because he's still trying to struggle with how to begin.
Pero el que me trajo aquí.
But the one that brought him here.
Me va a dar la estrategia, me va a dar la manera y lo vamos a lograr en el nombre de Jesús.
But the person that brought him, he's going to set out a plan, and he's going to bring it out to the name of Jesus Christ.
And that plan is worked with so that in our Hispanic ministries in the Northwest Texas Senior Conference, about once a week, Jorge will gather with the work that we're doing in Plainview and in Lubbock and Odessa. We'll bring those pastors together, and they have a coordinated plan where they learn from each other, they learn what's working, and quite frankly, across the United States, get this, folks, across the United States, other conferences are asking, how is it that it's so successful in the Northwest Texas Annual Conference and we haven't been able to do it? And here's why. This is sort of Birch Redneck version. It's because our Hispanic ministry folk have realized if we grab someone from the indigenous Hispanic culture, get the appropriate work visas and bring them here, the gap of in culture and language is so small that membrane is almost see-through like saran wrap. But you bring un grande gringo, you know, to try and reach people. There's so many gaps in communication and culture. So we've got this thing doing it right, and we're going to be reaching people. So will he have people gathered in his home to start this ministry?
¿Usted piensa de unirse en su casa primera vez?
Sí, cómo no.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Off the kitchen of this home, there is a renovated garage that's been converted into home space. And from what little Spanish I was able to pick up, basically it was, oh, this is where we can gather people. I mean, they were looking and saying, where are the people? How can we gather the people? And that was just so inspiring to me. And I wondered, do you and I have that same attitude and spirit that, do we have that tenacious humility just to reach out to people and to invite people and to have a conversation about faith in Christ? Sometimes I think we're a bit more hesitant. So the last question I want to ask is, who does he want to reach?
¿A quién quiere alcanzar con su ministerio?
Bueno, esta es una nación de oportunidades.
This is the nation of opportunity.
Me doy cuenta que hay iglesias de todo tipo.
There's all kinds of churches here.
Y parece que satisfacen todas las necesidades.
And it looks like a lot of these churches satisfy a lot of the needs.
Pero siempre hay algún sector de la sociedad.
But there is always a sector of the society.
Que se siente como fuera de contexto, de lugar.
That they may feel out of place or not wanted.
Que no tienen una iglesia donde ir.
That don't have a church home to go to.
A esas personas queremos alcanzar.
That's who I want to reach.
Si no queremos alcanzar los alcanzados.
He doesn't want to reach the ones who have been reached, the ones who are tired.
Sino yo sé que hay muchas personas.
He says that he knows that there's a lot of people out there.
Que Dios sabe dónde están.
God knows where they're at.
Y lo andamos buscando. Eso
and he's going to find them and bring them in.
So what you're going to see with this ministry is we're providing office space. We have a space of an office on the third floor that wasn't being used. It's air conditioned every day. It's now going to be the office for Pastor Emerson Cruz Pena and our partnership with the Northwest Texas Annual Conference. We'll teach him how to use the copier. This is where he'll be officing. Is it likely that we would be a gathering place for some gatherings? Maybe, but the approach that Pastor Emerson will take will be so radically different than what we think of that you may not see a lot of gathering here, but you're going to see a lot of difference making happening in the community itself. And you're going to be a part of that. Now, over the next 2 years, what we need to be praying and thinking about as a church is, do we want to continue to help that? In other words, quite simply, the conference is taking the initiative to begin it. In the next 2 years, as we think about what we want to be as a church that historically has been a difference maker within this community, do we want to fold this new ministry into who we are and to absorb it? What you will see is Pastor Emelson's name on our webpage, and you will see him here at the office. He has a direct number. We made a recording this morning for the TV congregation in Spanish, so that anyone who might be speaking Spanish might have the opportunity to know how to get a hold of Pastor Emelson. His phone number was on the television screen. We want to simply take all that we are as Polk Street and to simply leverage the opportunity that, friends, cost us nothing to simply communicate what's happening. But I want to ask us to pray and think, where do we want it to lead us? Could this be another new generation of influence that we would have in building the body of Christ and God's kingdom here? I live between being humbled and being inspired. And most often it's being humbled because of what I see in Maida and Emelson. I wanted you to hear from him, to know who he is. And I would like to have an opportunity as a congregation for us to offer a prayer for Maida and Emelson as we move our service to a close. So Maida, if you will come join us at the front, and I'll have Pauline translate for us.
Yeah, Pauline.
Now, here I am as pastor, Pauline's translator. What I'm looking for is Kim Davis. You represent the Compass Ministries of our church. You're an extension of who we are. So I'd like you to come stand behind Pastor Emelson and Maida and put your arms on them. And with Kim's presence, she represents all of you as a congregation here as we bow together in prayer. And I'll have Pauline transport me. O God of grace and love,
O Dios de gracia y el amor,
we give you thanks.
Te damos gracias.
For Emelson and Maida.
For Emelson y Maida.
For their heart.
Por su corazón.
And for their willingness to follow the call of Christ.
Y por la dedicación de seguir la palabra de Dios.
Bless them with the strength of your Holy Spirit.
Bendícelos con todo tu poder de Dios.
And use them both as your instruments.
Y usa los dos como instrumentos.
To share the good news of the love of Jesus Christ.
Para hablar la palabra de Dios de Jesucristo.
With all that do not know it.
Con todos los que no saben la palabra.
This we pray in the name of the Father.
Todo lo rezamos en el nombre del Padre.
And the Son.
Y el Hijo.
And the Holy Spirit.
Y el Holy Espíritu.
And the people of God did say.
Y la gente de Dios dijo.
Amen.
Amen.
Would you please affirm the courageous and faithful step of Emelson and Maida in coming to Amarillo and let them know of your love?